In this video, we're going to look at the spectrum processing data window and the principal component analysis property page. And we're going to look at one of the simpler ways of using this property page, and that is to perform a basic principal component analysis of a set of spectra. Now, the reason that we would perform a PCA on a set of spectra is because we have spectra that are essentially the same, but for a few minor peaks within the spectrum. These ToF data are ideal in this sense. The important information is probably buried within the smaller peaks rather than these larger peaks, and this is precisely where PCA plays a role in separating the overall trend from minor trends within a data set. There are two things we ought to do before we do the principal component analysis. The first one is to convert the data from a time plot into mass bins. As these data are displayed, these are all time bins. That is to say, when a mass spectrum using a ToF system is collected, the events that are recorded are in terms of time. And we have to do a calibration to convert time to mass. And when we convert time to mass, we will lose information because there's a relationship that is the square root between the mass and the time. However, in order to do a principal component analysis, we must have data that are aligned, and therefore a calibration is important. So what I will do first is to calibrate these using an option on the SIMS toolbar that will allow me to time to mass calibrate data. And what I'm going to do is use a relatively small number of mass bins. And the reason I'm doing this is to help with the explanation of PCA. It'll be much easier to display and explain the results of PCA if we don't have too many mass bins that we have to process in terms of display. So when I press OK, these time bins will all be converted into a limited number, 20,000 mass bins. So the three spectra that were previously displayed as time bins are now overlaid as mass bins, and you can see one of the consequences of the limited number of mass bins is that the resolution that you see here is far worse than you would see in the time bins. But in terms of displaying the data, this will be helpful. The second thing that will be useful is to rearrange the display. What I'm going to use are options on the tile display parameters dialog window, and we'll go with the Y axis first. What I want to do is offset the data, and offset the data using rather than 90% of the display tile, I'm going to use 30% for each one of the spectra. So if I press the apply button, I now see the spectra are offset. The next thing that I want to do is I want to normalize using a range normalization. And this is indicated by these vertical lines. And what this means is that the spectra will be displayed in each one of these display plots independently of each other. And the reason I want to do that is because the spectrum, after it's been processed, will produce one abstract factor that will have the most variation in the data set. And the other two abstract factors will have the variation that does not belong to that largest distribution of information, and so they tend to be small. Hence, I need to have a normalized range. I would also like to use the x-axis display, so rather than simply having a display along the bottom, I'd like to have each one of these plots with an axis scale. So these together will allow me to see for each one of these plots the current mass scale. If I zoom out, we can see currently the three mass bin spectra that are organized so that when I perform a principal component analysis, we'll immediately see the results of that principal component analysis. To transform these spectra into abstract factors, we need to use the principal component analysis property page, or the PCA page, and we're going to use the number of factors to specify how many abstract factors we want to calculate. And then another button that is important is to tick the button that says calculate specified factors. So when I specify 3, it will actually calculate 3. If I'd specified 10 when this is ticked, it would calculate 10 if they were there. We only have a data set of 3, so we can only calculate 3. But when we have a large data set, we don't want to have to spend the time to calculate all of the abstract factors, when the ones that will be interesting to us may just be the first half dozen. In this case, we've just got 3. So to calculate these abstract factors and transform these spectra into abstract factors, you press the Generate Factors button. And the result of the Generate Factors button is we see the first abstract factor on the top, and this one represents the greatest variation in the data. Now the spectra were all very similar, so this greatest variation looks very similar to the original spectrum. However, these second and third abstract factors represent differences from this general trend. So these are small variations that are found within the 3 spectra. And this is the reason that PCA can be useful for identifying peaks that have undergone some kind of adjustment as a result of measuring the sample in different ways or different samples. An alternative perspective for abstract factors is to consider how a scatter plot of the original spectra are transformed by a principal component analysis calculation. So we'll return these data to the original spectra, and now we're going to form a scatter plot where each data bin within the 3 spectra furnish an intensity, and each spectrum represents one axis in a 3-dimensional space. So we have an x-coordinate from the first spectrum, y from the second, and a z-coordinate from the third, and we plot a point in a 3-dimensional cube. To see this 3-dimensional cube, we'll use some options on the tile display parameters dialog window and adjust the display so that we have no offset. Let's set the range to be 90% rather than 30%. We'll take off normalization, and on the geometry property page we'll select scatter plot. We won't reverse the plot, and we will select the display of principal axes. Now the principal axes are directions in the 3-dimensional plot that are related to the abstract factors. So this display is quite useful in understanding what happens when a principal component analysis is performed. So I'll press apply, and we initially have a plot that is based on the 3 spectra. And the fact that these spectra are all very similar means that the plot of these points in a 3-dimensional cube that derive from the intensities from each data bin, they all lie pretty much along the diagonal of the cube, this leading diagonal of the cube. And the calculation of the principal axes is indicating this same information, that the main axis that is calculated in terms of these abstract factors, or the first abstract factor, is computed to be a vector that is pointing along this leading diagonal. Now when I perform a principal component analysis based on 3 abstract factors, that means all 3 will be transformed. The coordinates used to plot points within the cube are now taken relative to these abstract factors rather than the spectra themselves. So the intensities from the abstract factors provide the coordinate information in terms of x, y, and z, and as a result, we see rather than along the leading diagonal that the spread is now pointing along the x-axis. And the y and z-axis represent these minor abstract factors, and the size of these principal axes indicates that these are minor changes, and they're distributed about the leading diagonal. When viewed as a scatter plot, these abstract factors are showing that when we have 3 spectra that are very, very similar, such as these ToF SIMS data, then by performing a PCA, what we're doing is we're gathering together all the information that is in common with these 3 spectra, and then the second and third abstract factors are showing us the differences that are occurring between the 3 spectra that we can use to identify different mass peaks within the spectra that are of significance to the analysis.